God bless you. We'll start in 2 seconds. Amen. Please share this broadcast and get those who you know involved and get them on. And we'll be right with you in 2 minutes. Amen. God bless you. This is for the Bible student who's seeking to take their relationship with God even further. So please like and share. Please share this video. Amen. This broadcast and the video after we finish broadcasting. So God bless you for being on this morning with Bishop Robert Johnson. Today's subject is found in the book of Colossians, the book of Revelations, and the book of Genesis. Amen. It is our goal and our purpose to come on and celebrate the life of Jesus, his death, burial, and resurrection through the purpose of teaching redemption. Amen. There are so many people who attend church, who attend services, but yet they're void of God's word. And the only way to be a true Christian is one who has identified or in a covenant relationship with God himself, whereby the constitution of your life, you're not governed by your own abilities, but you're governed by the will and the word of God. Stay tuned as we venture into part 14 of redemption. God bless you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your people this morning. Those who seek to know you through your word. Those to seek who need a clearer understanding of your planned purpose for their life. And God, we ask that you speak to us this morning and give your people what's necessary in order for them to know you in the power of your suffering, the power of your resurrection, and in the power of your spirit. God, for this cause we say thank you, because you came into the world that we might have life and have it more abundantly. These and other blessings we ask in Jesus' name, and we pray, amen. Amen. Again, so thank you for being on with us. All those who are tuning in, God bless you. And we want to deal with part 14 of redemption. And we're going to deal with it from the perspective of Christology. Amen. Understanding what Christology is, because there are so many individuals who are either Old Testament scholars or they're New Testament scholars, but they don't understand the truth of God's word. Amen. Revelations 1 and 8, Jesus declares that I'm Alpha, Omega, the beginning and the end. Then in John 5:39, that same Jesus says to the religious leaders, you study the scriptures or you read the scripture, for in them you think you have eternal life. But these are those that testify of me. Amen. And the word testimony is to be or to declare the works of someone else based on them going away. Hebrews 9:17 says to where there is a testator, there is no power until there is a death of the testator. So we thank God for you who are tuning in with us today as we venture into redemption, part 14. Here we go. So we want to deal and define the word Christology, a branch of Christian theology relating to the person, nature, and the role of Christ. Then if we look at theology is the study of nature, the study of the nature of God and religious beliefs. I want to eliminate the last two words, religious belief, and I want to change that. So when in changing it, it will now read the study of the nature of God and a covenant relationship with God. We study God to be in divine covenant relationship based on Psalms 91. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow. Listen, I need you to understand there is an anointed place in God that he wants for you and I to exist. But the only way this is going to happen, there has to be someone willing to teach everyone from a theological perspective, love, the preach, the homily has become so defining that its characteristics based 90% of the time are of emotion for its hearers. But then what we need to understand, we need to teach God's word because it's written in the old covenant, Isaiah 34:16, God says, seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read. None shall fail, none shall lack her mate. For my mouth hath commanded and my spirit hath gathered them. So we get the definition here. So let's move on. So what we want to do today is introduce you to part 14 so you can have an understanding and go back and study so you will have greater understanding into the plan of redemption. So here we go. So the first covenant promise found in Genesis 3:15, this is the first prophetic statement that we hear from God. Yes, if you read the book of Genesis, it's truly not really the prophetic first statement because the first chapter of the book of origin of Genesis is not when things happen. That God shows us there in chapter 1, his voice will be the profound prophetic letter to man. So in chapter 1, he writes as though it has happened, but it does not come into fruition into chapter 2. So this is why we're doing this teaching on redemption. So you'll see God's love letter has a basis for you and I, that if we read it through the eyes of understanding, because we have the mind of God, God will begin to reveal to us his will for our lives. So then we go back to Genesis 3:15 and it says, and I will put enmity. The word enmity is simply represent or means a feud or a blood feud. Now watch this, between thee and the woman and between thy seed and her seed. Amen. Yet woman does not have a seed here, but God will use a woman as an incubator to carry the miraculous birth of the man Jesus. I like when the Bible says in Isaiah 9:6, for unto us a child is born and a son is given. If I can deal with the first part of that text, it says a child will be born. So then the woman becomes the incubator. She becomes the flesh representation of birth, giving heir to a child. But then the Bible said that son would be given. So the son represents the redemptive power through his blood that Jesus shed on the cross. So the purpose of the child which would be born is so that he would be given for the sin of the world, whereby you and I do not have to live in the shadows of darkness in sin because of the birth of the man Jesus. It was just not his birth, but the Bible says in Isaiah 53:10, for it pleased the Father to bruise him. That's why he was given. A child is born and a son is given. Then the Bible also says in Hebrews and Philippians, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame. Why? Because the son was given. You got to understand, God gave his son to redeem us. Yet according to the will of the flesh, we see him identified as the son of Abraham, the seed, the son of Isaac, the seed, the son of Jacob, the seed. And Revelation, the fifth chapter, says that he is the son of David according to the will of the flesh. Then I need you to understand, that's why David, God had a direct line of communication with him, and God speaks in David's life, and God says anything that he does, if he does wrong, he said, I will chasten him with the rod of correction. In other words, there are several men in the Bible who no one could do anything to but God himself. Jeremiah is another one, the weeping prophet. So let me get back here. I don't want to go too far. And between her seed. So seed here represents the word of God. And I'll tell you why I say that. If you go with us to the book of 1 John, I believe, chapter 3 and verse 9. It says, anyone born of God cannot sin, for the seed of the word of God remains in them. That's why the Bible says, again, that we are to study to show thy ourselves approved unto God. A workman need not be ashamed, who's able to rightly divide the seed of truth, the word of truth, the word of God. So what God is saying here, I'm going to put my word in the woman. So the word here is plural. The word seed here is plural because his understanding after the death of Jesus, Jesus said before he dies, greater works shall you do because I go to my Father. So then the seed represents presentation did not stop with the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It begins now with you and I. So the purpose of redemption is for you and I to do the work that Jesus did as a man here on earth. That's why he gave us the gifting of the Holy Spirit. John 14:2-6. If I go not away, the Father cannot send the Comforter who he's going to send in my name. And the Comforter, he will teach you all things, whatsoever things I have said unto you, he will bring to your remembrance. You must understand, he is the Paracletus. He is the Holy Spirit. He is the representative that was sent to die for you and I, the man Jesus, the Spirit of God. Now watch this. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. By the seed of the woman may be meant the Messiah. The word seed sometimes signifying a single person. Genesis 44:25, 15:3, 21:13. And particular, Christ. So that's the part we're dealing with, Christology, the seed. So God bless you for those who are watching. Let's continue. And here's why I'm at. We go to church every Sunday. Most people attend church, they attend service, and they go home into the same old rut, the same old problems, the same situations, yet they heard an amazing word from the perspective, again, of a homily that was off the chain, kicking, pulling, screaming, scratching, whatever people do, holding their head. I do some of those things. But what I'm saying is this, at the same time, I make sure that the foundation of the Word of God is ministered into the hearts of all those that I lead, because I can't go home with them, but the Spirit through the Word of God can. And if they are suffering or going through, or there happen to be trials and tribulations, the Bible says that the Word of God is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among those who are sanctified. Amen. If you know anything about a will or understand it, inheritance is a possession. That's what we're studying now in the book of Genesis in regards to Jacob. He's about to bless his sons in chapter 48 and 49 of Genesis. We're studying in Bible study. So what am I saying? Child of God, the inheritance is found in the Word of God. The will is there, but you have to open it to read it to know what's yours. Hallelujah. Okay, now let's go to the next part. We're going to Hebrews now, chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10, if you have your Bibles, I need you to read with us, because now you're going to understand why. This is so important. Watch this. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, thou hast no pleasure. So wait a minute. Are you telling me that God had no pleasure in the Old Testament sacrifices that he gave Moses according to the Levitical law and the covenant understanding that Moses received on top of the mountain? God said he really didn't have pleasure in it, because they could only offer atonement one time a year. So then the law itself was only a shadow of the good thing which was to come. But the redemption purpose and power was found in the blood of Jesus. What can wash away our sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make us whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. So please consider this now. God bless you to everyone who's tuning in. Then watch this. Here is the part that's critical that a lot of people are missing when we deal with Christology. Because a lot of people want to separate God and Christ. You can't separate God's purpose from him. The purpose was his son, Jesus. So we're going to get to that. We're dealing with this particular text. So now let's look at it. He says, then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book, and it is written of me to do thy will, O God. Watch what Jesus says now. Above, when he said, sacrifices and offering and burnt offerings and offerings for sin, thy word is not. God says, neither had its pleasure in them, which were offered by the law. So then what does God do? God wraps himself in flesh, comes here to the earth to redeem you and I, because God never really had pleasure in burnt offerings and sacrifices, because the things that were given undone then were only a shadow or an image of the good thing which was to come. That's Jesus Christ himself. So what am I saying? So many times, many of us get caught up in the theatrics of church, yet we don't study God's word. The imagery has changed over the last 20 years from the preacher, from the evangelist, from the apostle, the bishop. Things have changed. The covenant understanding has changed because there are people now who are saying you don't need the Old Testament. Well, that's incorrect because Jesus Christ is the voice of God all throughout the Bible. So how can you separate God's voice from his purpose and his plan? So then Isaiah 34:16 again says, you do need it. For he says, seek ye out of the book. He never says seek ye out of the Old Testament or the New Testament. He says the book. God's word is one volume in 66 books. We had encyclopedias growing up as a child, and we used to ask our mom, we're missing one, this particular book from the encyclopedia. Mom, when are you going to buy it? God is saying the same thing. That's what he says again in John 5:39. He tells those religious leaders, you read the word and that you think you have eternal life. He said, but these are those that testify of me. Then to verify that, Jesus says in Revelation 1:8, I'm Alpha, Omega, the beginning and the end. In other words, you can't have Revelations without Genesis. You can't have Isaiah without Matthew. Well, why do you say that, Bishop? Because again, Isaiah 9:6, in the love letter written by God in his prophetic voice in Isaiah, it's answered in by the angel in Matthew 1:1. So if you eliminate Isaiah as those Judaizers did because they didn't understand the messianic promises and the covenant that God had with man. So in the Talmud or the Torah under Judaism, they do not state it. That's why when they found Jesus in the temple at 12 years old reading that book, they were profound because they were scholars, yet they could not understand it. But Jesus was reading what was written about him. Yeah, there was never a struggle because again in Hebrews 10:7, he said, then said I, lo, I come in the volume of a book. So there was no problem interpreting his own life. If you remember, I'll give you another example. The Bible declares that when John the Baptist was in prison and he was about to lose his head, I've said this before and I'm going to keep saying it, Jesus sent word back to John through his disciples. And he said, go tell John that the blind have received their sight. Go tell John that the dumb have opened, their ears are open. Go tell John that the lame is walking. Not only are they walking, but they're leaping. Well, why was Jesus able to say this? Because he is the covenant agreement of the word of God. He is God's word. John 1:1, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. There was nothing that was made that was made without the word. That's why in Hebrews 10:7, he said, then Jesus says, then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book, and it was written of me. So if you read Isaiah 35, you'll see that God prophetically speaks before the life of Jesus. This time that Jesus is sending word back to John to tell him that, listen, go tell John the blind of the eyes are open. Isaiah 35 says the blinded eyes will be open. Go tell him that the lame is walking. Isaiah 35 says the lame will be walking. Go tell him that the dumb are hearing. Isaiah 35 says the dumb would hear. So do you see what's going on? Jesus Christ himself can only give you what was written about his life prophetically before his birth. We're almost done. Don't leave on us. Don't leave on us. We're almost done. What I was talking about in Revelations, watch this, chapter 5. This is a covenant book of covenant understanding. You really need to study the Revelation, the entire book, so you can get a prophetic understanding for those who, especially, who are prophets. It just gets me, but I'm not going to even go into there. I'm going to leave that alone. All right, so let's go to Revelations chapter 5. The entire Bible is one central story, redemption. Putting us back into the place that Adam forfeited. Putting us back in the covenant agreement. Revelation 22:1-5. All right, watch this. Let's go to right now, Revelations chapter 5. And I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with seven seals. The number seven is God's number of completion. It is God's number of completion to say that there is no void occasion or nothing in it that's invalid, but the word of God is valid. So it was sealed with God's seal of authority. Now watch this. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof? You must understand the book is the book of life. It represents a period of time where God will open the book to show whose names are written there. But those names have already been identified. Do you not know God already knows who's going to be saved and who will make it? Do you not know he already has placed us in that position to know what's for us, when it's for us, and how it's for us? Watch this. Watch this now. Number 3. And no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. The book represents life, child of God. So if you are not Jesus, how are you able to give life except through the word of God, which is the seed book? It is the life. That's why there's no time for fake prophecy, false prophets, anyone who does not know the word. It amazes me how some people will preach 2 minutes, but yet prophesy for an hour. Wait a minute, you have to give me the essence of the God's word, right? Because life was in the blood, and the blood caught the constitution of the blood was because of the word. So how can you give me something, or how can you make something come into fruition that never existed? Your words only. That's why the Bible said that his word will go out and never return void. You can't give anyone anything outside the scope of the word of God. If you do, we are lying to them. Now watch what John says in verse 4. And I wept much because no man was found worthy. Watch this. No man. And I wept much. No man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look therein. Now watch this. Catch me now in verse 5. And one of the elders said unto me, weep not. Here we go. Christology. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Genesis 49 and 10. The scepter will not depart from Judah until Shiloh comes, neither a lawgiver from between his feet. That's the law given to Moses. And till there be a gathering of his people, the scepter shall not depart from Judah. That's why Saul could have never been Israel's king, which means Jacob's son, because Saul was not, first of all, not one of Jacob's son. Second of all, Saul was from the tribe of Benjamin and not Judah. So you hear it says, verse 5, and one of the elders said unto me, weep not, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Watch this, the root of David. Jesus Christ, according to the will of the flesh, is the offspring of David, based on the promise given to Dave, to David's great-great-grandfather Abraham. Oh, that same promise now is in the line of the King of David, who is the root. Jesus Christ is the root of David. Watch this. It says he has prevailed to open to the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. Now listen what he says in verse 6. Christology. This is where it's critical. Listen what he says. And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne, and of the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb, as though it had been slain. Peter, put away the sword. No man take my life, but I lay it down. In the midst of the four beasts and of the elders, stood a lamb, as though it had been slain. Watch this. Having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into the earth. Everything that was in God was sent into the earth in the man Jesus to redeem you and I back to himself. Child of God, you are blessed today because God loved you that much to send his son to die for you and I. This has been Bishop Johnson with part 14 of Redemption. Tomorrow, I'll come back on with part 14b so we can conclude understanding Christology and the purpose of the man Jesus for redemption. Child of God, you don't have to be in a dark place. You don't have to be in a dry place. You don't have to give up, and you don't have to live in sin. All God wants you to do is trust him and to live in him. So what do I want to say right now? I want to tell you that God loves you. If you don't have a church home, please find a church in your area. Tell that church that you need to be baptized and that you need Christ to open up doors and ways of your life. God bless you. We love you very much this morning. This has been Bishop Johnson. Stay blessed in